Growing up, I was never the biggest Star Trek fan. When it came to Star Trek vs. Star Wars, I was definitely more of a Jedi than a Trekkie. What I did watch of Star Trek was because of my mom, who watched from the original series up until at least Deep Space Nine. As I grew older, I did begin to watch a bit, but for some reason, I always gravitated more towards The Next Generation for some reason. On that note though, I have seen a few of the original series movies, Generations, First Contact, and the first of the J.J. Abrams movies. That being said, my Star Trek knowledge is somewhat limited. The video games, though, are, well, about the same, actually. Growing up, I had only played a couple of Star Trek games, both based off of the original series. The first was Star Trek 25th Anniversary on the NES, which, despite it being kind of mediocre overall, I still enjoyed it. Then there was a PC game, which was more of a point-and-click style of game than the NES version. Plus, the ship-to-ship combat was actually challenging at times, at least when I was a kid. Despite that, with all the other Star Trek games out there, I'd never actually played any other Star Trek games. Until now. This month, I'm going to take a look at not one, but four Star Trek games. The two based on the original series I played as a kid, and two based on The Next Generation, which I barely had any experience with until just recently. What's up, everyone? My name is NeoScyther, and I'd like to welcome you all to Star Trek Month.
Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise. Its continuing mission, to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life in new civilizations, to boldly go where no one has gone before.
Star Trek 25th Anniversary was released in February of 1992 on the NES. The game begins with the crew of the USS Enterprise approaching Sigma Iosha 2. However, the ship gets caught up in some sort of tear in space that sends them somewhere unknown. While trying to escape the tear, the dilithium crystals become fused and essentially useless. As they sit trapped in a decaying orbit above an unknown planet, Spock detects small traces of dilithium crystals on the planet's surface. Kirk leads an away team onto the planet to find the crystals, but they're not enough to get the ship back to Sigma Iosha 2, forcing the crew to stop off at several more planets to find the necessary dilithium crystals. While combat is involved now and then, Star Trek is more of a puzzle-solving game, with each planet having certain puzzles to solve to eventually obtain the dilithium crystals to be able to move on. When you go down to a planet's surface, you have to put together an away team that consists of Kirk and two other crew members. Typically, one of them is probably going to be Spock, and a lot of times, the other will be Dr. McCoy. There are other crew members, though, including a historian, biologist, geologist, and a security officer, who, for the record, is a red shirt. These other crew members are rarely needed. In fact, one of them technically isn't needed at all if you know what you're doing, but I'll get back to that in a bit as it kind of ties in with one of my overall complaints with this game. As the game begins proper, you'll transport down to the planet below via cutscene. You're basically free to roam around each planet as you wish and interact with what you find. I'll come back to this in a bit, but one piece of advice with this game, it's kind of important to examine everything. Pressing A near something will do one of two things, either make a buzzing sound meaning there's nothing of importance to examine, or someone will pull out their tricorder and examine what you found. Believe it or not, the first planet is probably one of the largest areas to explore, and going in the wrong direction basically means death. You can hit start to pull up a menu to check items, transport back to the ship, switch your phaser between stun and full, and talk to your away team. Though most of the time, I never found a good time to do that, since just hitting A at the right moments will use the tricorder. Now, when I played through this for this recording, I'd played it through recently and several times as a kid, so for the most part, I knew exactly where to go. Also keep this point in mind for later. When you first arrive on the planet, you're told there's a structure to the north and a village to the south. You can try to go north, but you'll likely die via these little bloodworms before reaching the structure, so your other option is to head south toward the village if you're following Spock's findings. This is basically how you progress the game for a good part of it. You go somewhere, interact with something or someone which leads you to something else, you go there, lather, rinse, repeat. However, as stated, this is somewhat of a puzzle-solving game, and each planet you visit in your mission will have at least one to solve, if the planet itself isn't the puzzle. Once you make your way to the temple, you find some symbols written on the walls which look suspiciously like the symbols on the Led Zeppelin 4 album. Anyway, these are involved in another puzzle to solve. Once you make it through the temple, you'll eventually find what you're after, the dilithium crystals. You're beamed back to the ship and can now interact with the crew and see a few other things. When you hit start, you'll pull up a menu with nearly a dozen options, most of which you really don't need. You can choose to talk to the six main crew members aboard the ship, but most of the time you really don't need to, as there's really nothing of note here. In fact, of the other options, save and the map are the most used, outside the transporter obviously, as save will display a password that you can use to resume your progress if you turn the system off, and you use the map to travel between planets. The communicator is only used once, and the red alert button, well, I'll get to that one in a bit. So, what do you do now? Well, if this is your first time playing, you probably have no clue where to go next. There are several planets you can go to, but most of them are completely worthless. Sure, when you're going to the transporter room, Spock and Kirk will talk about the possibility of small amounts of dilithium on the planet, but nothing significant enough to get the ship to where you need to go. You can explore most of these planets, but they're basically one screen wrapping around with nothing of note. So, how do you know which planet is next in your mission? Well, you can actually do a process of elimination. You can scroll the map as far left or right as it goes, showing you all of the planets in the game. You know you need to get ultimately to Sigma Iosha 2, just called Iosha here for short. But choosing that doesn't work yet, as you can't go that far. While you can just keep going backwards until you find the planet you can go to, you'll soon see the neutral zone where Shroud 4 is, but to get to any of these areas, you have to cross through Romulan territory. Now, I'm not a Star Trek expert, but I'm guessing that Kirk and the Romulans don't exactly get along, as we'll see later. The planet just before the Romulan territory is Lakaithos, which just happens to be the correct destination. By the way, don't worry about running out of dilithium while choosing a planet. You can go back and forth between planets all day long, but landing on Lakaithos mysteriously makes you run out of dilithium, regardless of how long it takes you to get there. I'm not going to go into much detail about the other planets, as I don't want to spoil this too much, but following Lakaithos, the game will tell you where to go next from here, so that part's easier. However, now you get to cross into Romulan territory, as you basically have no choice. A Romulan ship will stop you and demand that you state your business, then you just see the ship on the screen. You basically have two options here, diplomacy or combat. Basically, you can try and talk your way through, or just engage the Romulan ship in battle. This is the one time where you can go and press that big red alert button, but personally, I prefer hitting the communicator and talking my way out of things. Less messy and, well, let's face it, I'm in a Federation-class starship, you're in what appears to be a Romulan bird of prey, and I have a cocky ship captain who can probably blow you out of space. Now, if you think there's no space combat at all, there is. Just not yet. That comes after the following mission on Shroud 4. This game does take a couple of specific references to the TV series besides just the main characters and crew as well as the Romulans. Harry Mudd makes an appearance as he's trying to make a deal with some Romulans and ultimately gets captured. You'll set him free, which kind of upsets the Romulans, and then they'll approach you again as you try to leave, but now you have no choice but to go into ship-to-ship combat. Thankfully, it's not too difficult if you know what you're doing. Pay attention to the lower part of the screen. You'll see a small orange arrow on the left that will point you into the direction of the Romulan ship, two indicators that show the shield statuses of both the Enterprise and the Bird of Prey, and an energy meter for your phasers. You use the D-pad to fly the ship around to locate or avoid the Bird of Prey. You can use A and B to fire off photon torpedoes or phasers. The phasers are quick, but weak. They'll do a bit of damage to the ship's shields, but they do have to recharge for a few moments. Photon torpedoes are a bit more powerful, but are really slow. You basically have to lead your shots with them if you want to hit anything. If you're good at avoiding the Romulan ship's fire, combat isn't all that difficult. Once the ship is down, you progress toward the next planet, Sigma Iosha 2, the final stop in your mission. This is probably my favorite planet in the game, and, believe it or not, is actually from the TV series. In fact, a lot of these planets might be, but this one specifically references the series, as the plot of the game is actually a reference to the episode A Piece of the Action. At the end of that episode, Dr. McCoy states that he accidentally left his communicator down on the planet. Remember that Terran space at the start of the game? The plot of the game is to go to Sigma Iosha 2 and find out what caused that tear. What ends up happening is that to correct the issue, they need to go back in time and get Dr. McCoy's communicator so the planet's inhabitants can't use it for their own purposes, thus no Terran space. Because. With that in mind, Kirk has the Enterprise do a slingshot around Iosha's sun to travel back in time, because that makes sense, and return to Iosha 2 in the past to retrieve McCoy's communicator. Star Trek on the NES isn't that bad of a game, but I do have a couple of issues with it. The first and probably biggest issue I have, bar for one, which I'll get to in a moment, is that it's pretty short. If you know what you're doing, you can probably complete the game in about 45 minutes to an hour, give or take, and even less so if you're really good at it. The superfluous crew members beyond Spock and McCoy are basically used only once each, and as stated, the biologist isn't needed at all, though he does have a few useful hints in the third mission. The geologist, historian, and security officer are all only used once, though thankfully you'll generally get a hint while on the appropriate planet that someone else may be able to help. For the most part, you'll always want to have Spock with you, but McCoy isn't really needed that much. On that note, the game only has four planets that are part of the story. I did some experimenting when it came to exploring the galaxy. If Kirk ever runs out of health on a planet, he'll become gravely injured, and the away team will get beamed back to the ship. However, any progress made on a planet is kept, and you can just beam back down to continue. You can also have Scotty beam you back up at any time if you need to change crew members. These are the only ways to look around the ship during the first mission, since the game forces you down to it via cutscene. Since your ship is stuck during the first mission, you can't move anywhere. After the first mission, you can't go any further right than the Kythos. After that, you know you have to go to Shroud 4, but that'll put you into Romulan territory where you're forced to go straight to Shroud 4. I tried to go backwards after finishing that, but the Romulans stop you and the scene from earlier takes place, forcing you back to Shroud 4, and then you're forced to move on to Iosha 2. The other main issue I have, which ties into the game being so short, is that a lot of the options just aren't used. Talking to the crew on the ship doesn't really do much, but then there's that big red alert button. Earlier when you're forced to fight the Romulan ship after rescuing Harry Mudd on Shroud 4, you're taken right into combat and automatically put into red alert status. So what's that button for if you never have to press it? Well, remember back to when you first encountered the Romulans while crossing into their territory after Lakaithos? Instead of being diplomatic, you can just engage them in combat. This is the only time that you can press the big red alert button. But for the love of Archaeus, don't do it! You'll enter combat with the Romulan ship, and if you take it down, you'll continue towards Shroud 4. Except you'll be intercepted by another Romulan ship, and they aren't too happy that you just blew their comrades up. This will force you into another fight. Winning this will put you back on course, until another Romulan ship shows up to tear you apart. Now if at any time you lose a combat, whether here or during the force fight, your ship is stuck and you have to get towed back to Starfleet. This is basically game over, and really is the only way to technically lose. Well, actually it's not, but I'll get back to that in a moment. So what happens if you wipe the third Romulan ship off the map? Believe it or not, the Enterprise runs out of energy entirely. After all, you didn't think those small amounts of dilithium from Lakaithos would last forever, would you? Well, now the ship is stuck, floating in the dead of space, and at this point, the normal game over routine plays out, and you go back to the title screen. So besides the choose-your-own-adventure process when going to Shroud 4, the game overall is rather easy, with planetary combat being minimal, and ship-to-ship combat not being too difficult. However, there is one issue with the game that I can't forgive. It's one thing to be stuck on a puzzle with seemingly no way out. As I stated earlier, it's important to examine everything. You might have missed something small that can help out. Maybe you haven't talked to the right person yet, or find the right combination of items to use for a particular situation. But what if I said you can put yourself in a situation where it's physically impossible to finish the game, and it happens towards the end of the final planet? I said I would come back to this, and now it's time. When I say examine everything, I mean examine everything. In one building on Iosha 2, you'll come across two gangsters robbing a store. You can shoot them down, and then when you examine them, you'll get a diamond. This diamond is required to complete the game as far as I'm aware. However, if for whatever reason you take out the two robbers, regardless of whether your phaser is set to stun or full, and then go back to the Enterprise, whether on your own accord or because Kirk becomes gravely injured, the robbers will not be there lying on the ground when you get back. That means you can't examine them to get the diamond, thus you can't complete the mission. Congratulations, you just softlocked the game. That is extremely poor programming. Granted, the odds of this happening aren't that great if you've gotten used to examining everything and everyone, but the fact that you can do it at all is mind-boggling. I could go into my thoughts on how this works, but this is a game review, not a lesson in basic programming. And I don't mean the basic programming language, I mean the basics of programming. Despite all of that though, and despite how short the game is, and how very little a lot of the functions are used, if at all, Star Trek on the NES is still enjoyable for what it is. The graphics are pretty good for an NES game based on Star Trek, and the audio isn't all that bad. Even the 8-bit rendition of the original Star Trek theme isn't all that bad, at least if you can get past the high-pitched noises of the theme. However, do get used to the same few songs being played over and over again, and most of the songs are basically the same 2-4 measures repeated. It's okay, but variety is all I ask. There was a Star Trek game on the Game Boy, but it's not a port of the NES game, and is actually pretty different. If you're a fan of the original series, I'd say check out the game if you can find a copy of it, but you're not missing much if you don't. That's it for my review of Star Trek for the NES. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next week when we briefly abandon console gaming and check out Star Trek 25th Anniversary on the PC. Hey everyone, thanks for checking out my review of the original Star Trek for the NES. And I hope so far you're enjoying Star Trek Month, and there's still quite a bit more of it to go, including 3 more video game reviews and, believe it or not, 2 card game reviews. Yeah, I've been playing this for a while. If you're new to my channel and these are the only type of videos you've seen, I also do, well, normally monthly card game reviews, but this month I'm doing 2 of them, as I said, as well as the occasional random project, such as my current run-through of Kirby Star Allies on the Nintendo Switch. With that, I thank you guys for watching, and I will see you next time.